Hi everybody, Michael Davis here, and welcome to Bone2Pick. We are in for an incredible treat today. We are coming to you today from Belmont, Massachusetts, just outside of Boston, Massachusetts. And we are coming to you from the home of an icon in the world of jazz and trombone, the legendary Phil Wilson. Phil is internationally renowned to everyone for his incredible abilities as a trombonist, also as an arranger, and certainly as a jazz educator. He was an extremely important part of one of the great Woody Herman Thundering Herd bands of the early and mid-1960s. He went on to record 14 albums as a leader and solo artist. He received a Grammy nomination in 1969 for his classic arrangement of Mercy, 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 done for the Buddy Rich Band. And I can say, as a past member of the Buddy Rich Band, even when I was on the band, we got to play that chart regularly, and what a treat it was. It was like incredibly well crafted, and we're gonna get to pick Phil's brain about his approach to arranging as well.
I got news for you. That one, that was the last big band recording to get to the top 40.
Oh wow!
It was the last one.
That is
what a sad.
Awesome. Well, it's sad, but if there was one that should be the last one, it's probably that one. He taught at the great Berklee College of Music for over 50 years, one of its most distinguished professors. He's known worldwide as a guest artist and clinician. He appeared, one of my favorite things in discovering was he appeared in the 1964 Grammy Awards telecast with none other than Louis Armstrong. And perhaps nothing says it better than the city of Boston proclaiming December 9th, 1995 as Phil Wilson Day. So Phil, thank you so much for inviting us into your home and for just taking the time to be with us today on Bone2Pick.
Oh, I'm happy you're here, you know.
Well, look, just so excited about this. Let's talk about early Phil Wilson, just getting started in music.
You mean 82 years ago?
Anything in right around there sounds great. So to tell us about your beginnings and how you got into music.
Well, I started, I was born here. And I'm really a product of Ivy League prep schools in that my father was a history professor, founded hockey at this Belmont Hill School and all that sort of thing. And there was a piano in the back of the home where we lived. It was a dormitory.
Okay.
And if everybody was out of there, the three-year-old would go over there and start pounding on the piano. And bang, 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 and then, I started picking out church hymns, and usually in the key of A minor or C major.
Good choice.
Yeah, right. And I knew what I was doing was right. Now, you can ask, and how did a three-year-old or four-year-old in that area know it was right? You know that see if any that goes up your back when something's right?
Sure.
They should bottle that, you know. You know, right? That kept happening to me. And then I'd start improvising little simple things. And that kept happening. And that's, I knew that what I was stumbling on was good. And finally, at age five, we moved up to Phillips, Exeter. Dad, I have three sisters, and so it's a big family. Mm-hmm. And Dad got a job up there where he remained for the rest of his life. And I started taking lessons. That kid should take lessons. And I did. And there was this wonderful teacher up in Exeter, New Hampshire, named Betty Krieger. And I was one of her star performers because she could put me at one end of the living room where her piano was and play a note at the other end, and I can go F sharp, C sharp, you know. And that was an indication that I have very good pitch, which is true. And we found out through a very strange humorous recital for when I was 10 years old after taking lessons all this time. Again, nobody knew I was dyslexic at this point.
Okay.
I'm just a happy child, really.
Okay.
And comes to her year end recital, I've been honored to play the Star Speckled Banana. and so I get up there, get the book out, looking good, you know, dressing up, and I brought the house down playing a great version of the Star Speckled Banana. Uh-huh. And the only trouble was that she realized at that point that I was basically bullshitting. I was playing a version in the key of C, and that in front of me, the book, was in the key of A flat.
Oh, wow, okay.
So the next lesson, she pulled up real close to me at her and opened the book and said, play that. And I couldn't get through the first bar.
Wow, okay.
Boom, you know. She then realized that I had a reading problem. Mm-hmm. And dyslexic was not a word in those days. It wasn't in the dictionary. And she called my mother. That's a wise woman, this German woman. And she said, you know, I think Philly has got a reading problem, and I think he should change to a single-lined instrument. And maybe he'd have a chance of surviving in the music business. Mm.
She obviously recognized how strong your ear was, so your ear was getting you through all that.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
So I wanted to play trumpet because I loved Louis Armstrong.
Yeah, sure.
I got hung on to Louis with the All-Stars, and of course Jack Teagarden, that comes in later. But he just spoke to me. The phrasing, the feeling, emotionally, he had me. Mm-hmm. And so we couldn't afford a trumpet at the time. And there was a trombone in the loft of the Phillips Church up at Exeter, and that became mine. It wasn't too bad either. It was a Martin, I think, in those days.
A fortuitous finding for all of us trombone fans of yours.
And that night, it happened to be Christmas Eve that I got it, that year, and I went out with the carol sing with the trombone, only having picked it up that afternoon.
And I have
survived. Again, the ear.
Yeah.
Yeah, every time somebody did something in the key of F, that's first position. Ah, he's playing good, and then I wouldn't have to play anything until I got another F. So that kind of set things up. Then I had a dear friend starting about the age of 11 the next year, Tommy Gallant, who was a pianist, a wonderful pianist, who did more for musicians in the state of New Hampshire than any single person, with the possible exception of a band leader named Ted Herbert, giving more work to people. Mm-hmm. He was 2 years older than I was, and we would, after school, come to my house or his house. We lived about a quarter mile apart. And we would play standard tunes together every afternoon, just, you know, going through the book.
Crazy. Wow.
And we did that probably when I was 11, 12, 13, 14. And boy, that basically set a line of endeavor in my whole life of playing with great piano players. Mm. Such as Makoto Ozone and Cyrus Chestnut.
The great record you made with Makoto at the duo record.
Exactly. Awesome. I became part of the Phillips Exeter Jazz Band because at the age of 12.
Okay.
Because they didn't have a trombone player. Mm-hmm. And that was very valuable. So that I got pretty damn good at playing trad.
Oh, wow, okay.
You know, and that's... Okay. Thanks to Jack Teagarden and Vic Dickinson, we'll talk about later.
Sure.
And so Williams College had this trad band, and they won the Arthur Godfrey talent show. And so they needed a trombone player to play a two very important gigs. One when I was 15 at the Savoy Club here in Boston.
Okay.
We got special compensation.
Yeah, compensation
from the union to allow this 15-year-old to play for 2 weeks.
Okay.
But more even equally as important was the year later we had 2 weeks in Knicks in New York.
Okay.
And I was there also playing with their trombone player didn't show for the big gigs. I don't know what was going on in his head, but I was very happy it was going on because it gave me a platform to play some really nice jazz.
Yeah,
and,
that's awesome.
To grow, you know.
Yeah.
Then we get to Herb.
Okay. Yeah.
And Berklee came time to go to college. And I wanted to go to Berklee,
mm-hmm.
but I was not allowed to because my father, being a wise professor that he indeed was, said they don't give a degree. And in those days, they didn't. It was just a diploma. And so he said, you can't do that. You know, you need the piece of paper.
And this is 1955, you said?
This would be 1955,
okay.
Right? So I went to New England. Well, New England that year, I was initially happy about going to New England because their trombone teacher was John Coffey,
sure.
Legendary.
Of course, yeah, Boston City.
And
yeah.
Man, that's what I want. And so I was actually happy about going there. They fired him that summer.
Oh, no.
Yeah. They wanted him to be exclusive at New England. And just down the street on Huntington Ave, not a block away, he had his own studio where he had over 75 students from everywhere, you know.
Yeah.
What he'd say, well, what do you think I'm going to do, you know? Come down to New England so I can do six?
Yeah.
No. So he said later.
Oh, okay.
And so I ended up with a teacher who hated jazz. He became the new first trombone player at the symphony.
Mm.
He'd fall asleep in the lesson.
Oh, nice. Yeah.
And, you know, it didn't work.
Yeah.
There were a couple of teachers there who really were helpful. There's no question. One of them was Bill Tesson, and who was a marvelous teacher and was perfect for me, really. And the other was John Nadeau. But we won't go into that.
Okay.
So I didn't really have much interest in New England.
It wasn't your cup of tea, yeah.
But 10 blocks away was Berklee,
uh-huh.
And they always needed a trombone player for their ensembles and things like that. And that's where I was.
Awesome, yeah.
Yeah. And finally, that's where I met Bill Chase. And all of these guys who eventually ended up in the 62-3-4-5 Woody's band.
Wow.
And we're going to talk about that. I've got
a
complete list.
I can't wait to see it. And I know you have some great photos to share with us as well.
Right.
And,
I wanted to, I should also say one thing. Also, in 1954 at Phillips Exeter, where I was still as a junior at that point, Phil Fisculia, a great clarinet player from the symphony.
Well, great name, too.
Yeah.
Fisculia.
It took years of practice.
Yeah.
V-I-S-G-U something. Anyways. He also played decent jazz tenor and had done some work with Herb. So he said, you got to come down. And he talked to Herb about me. And he brought me down, and I sat in with Herb at the stables, and we played Bernie's tune, you know. And that was my introduction to him.
Wow.
And that turned out to be a nice relationship for the next 50 years.
Oh, my
really.
Gosh, that's an understatement. Yeah.
Right.
Wow.
He, just as a arranging teacher, His line writing class is legendary from composers all over the world now. And I'm one of the persons who benefited from that, along with that.
Well, he was certainly a pioneer.
He had a wonderful analytical mind, and his ability to analyze some of what Duke Ellington was doing was way past anything I ever saw. Mm-hmm. It was just magnificent. And matter of fact, he actually at one point in 1976, we played with the Boston Ballet, and that Such Sweet Thunder album, which is my favorite, one of my favorite Duke things, mm-hmm. especially Clark Terry, they couldn't find some of the scores from that, as well as there's another 10-inch, a 12-inch Columbia thing called Jazz Party with Duke, which is a wonderful album with a lot of people sitting in with the band. And there's Timpani Blues, something like that.
Uh-huh, yeah.
And they hired Herb to copy the records.
Oh, to take all the, to so transcribe that, the whole.
So record. That we wow. could do this ballet, the Phoebe Snow Ballet, with the Boston Ballet.
Nice.
And I get to play Britt Woodman's part. And I want to tell you, my respect for Britt Woodman went up 100%.
I have no doubt you did it justice.
I did indeed. I nailed that sucker.
Well, if we can, Phil, I want to just, because I want to come back to Herb when we talk more generally about the association with Berklee as a professor.
Sure.
But maybe we could jump forward a couple years to you joining the Dorsey Brothers Band. And you shared a little bit of the stories with us before, but Tommy had passed and then Jimmy had passed and you jumped on the band, and tell us a little bit about that kind of initial experience.
Well, they needed a trombone player, and my reputation was growing. Mm-hmm. And I just got a phone call one night from Tommy's booker, who is a legend in itself. I can't remember his name at the present moment. It doesn't make any difference. But for me, it was an escape because my grades were not good.
Okay.
And I was very happy doing what I was doing, but it sure wasn't coming out in grades. Mm-hmm. It was wrong school and everything. So this provided an excuse to get out into the real world, which I needed badly. Because, boy, you get raised in that Ivy League bubble.
Yeah.
The relationship to that and reality is two different things.
Right, boy.
Boy, you get out.
Well said.
You know, yeah, I know you
know
what
exactly
I'm talking.
What you're talking about. So yeah, I can imagine, even though Tommy and Jimmy had both passed, getting on a professional band of that caliber.
I was the only new kid on the band. It was the
band.
New York band. Mm-hmm. And it was a wonderful, you know, Tommy spent the top money on the best writers in the business. And we can just move ahead just a month, about a year. We lost a trumpet player, a piano player, who got absolutely drunk and fell off the bandstand in the Valair Ballroom in Des Moines, Iowa.
Okay.
And he was fired. And we could get Jack Jenny's brother, I think his name was Bill Jenny.
Okay.
William, I think that's right.
Okay.
That could, you know, he had a music store in Atlantic, Iowa, so he could come in and finish till we could hire another trombone player or a piano player. Wow. And I went over and played the piano.
Oh, wow, okay.
But it turned out I stayed there for about 6 months.
Really? Oh, okay.
Yeah. And that was basically my best arranging lesson, because Tommy, as I said, paid top dollar for the best, Eddie Sauter, Bill Finnegan, all the top writers were. Mm-hmm. And they were, the piano parts were written out in double score, not just the chord changes. And so with my dyslexia and my ear, I can get through. I'm a big Van fan, so I knew most of the charts by ear. But then I just spent all the time looking at the structures in these double stave parts to some, and that was my arranging lesson. Hmm. First decent one. They were beautiful, mm-hmm. absolutely beautiful. Bells of St. Mary by Bill Finnegan. Ooh, what a gorgeous, you know, beautiful stuff. And to say nothing of the original Sunny Side of the Street and Opus 1 and all that stuff, which is fun too, you know.
That's awesome. Yeah.
So I also would play screech trombone during South Rampart Street Parade. And after 6 months of doing that, my trombone playing was going down because I was doing screech trombone twice a night.
And then playing piano.
The rest of the time. So I got kind of frustrated with that, and I left and went with Al Belletta's sextet, which was, Al Belletta was a wonderful alto player. And this was a sextet where I sang baritone because we did kind of a four freshman thing and then some, you know, very comfortable West Coast jazz. And I played piano, I sang baritone, and played the trombone part also.
Wow.
And who's the tenor player Louis Belson's band, West Coast? Killer player.
Hmm. I'm drawing a blank myself.
Oh, come on. Oh, man. I'll think of it. Anyways, he was 18 at the time. He was on that band, and so was a trumpet player named Billy Hunt.
Okay.
Who later came on Woody's band with us in 62. So I did that until I got drafted into the Army, where after some amusing hits, I was offered to teach at the proposed Army School of Music, which they were hopeful would go through the Congress. Hmm. It did not go through, and so I was spirited out to NORAD in Colorado Springs, where they were just starting this band that was actually in the administrative. They were part of what do you call it? PR department, military PR department, not the music department. So all of these leaders in the Washington band and all this, they couldn't touch us.
Oh, that sounds like a good position to be in.
That's exactly what happened. So Paul Fontaine comes in, his Irby's brother, Al Green, comes in. Al Green, the gal's the one who taught Irby to play. He was the older brother of the three.
Uh-huh.
And he had been a colonel in the Air Force, responsible for a group of T-Birds. And one of his men, after being in the Air Force for 18 years, got into trouble. Hmm. And the base commander busted the kid, and they busted Al.
Oh, wow.
And Al, that means he's out, no pension, or he goes down to the lowest possible level and does his time out, 20 years, whatever, and then he gets his pension of the highest level he had, which was colonel, so that was sizable.
Uh-huh.
So he was a piano player originally, and he came out to the Nora band and became the pianist.
Okay.
Well, wow. I found out that he's Irby's brother.
Yeah.
So you got a trombone? We got one out of the and he got his trombone chops back together. And boy, it was interesting. I would be around just trying to pick up some of that against the grain playing he was into and all that sort of stuff, which is fascinating. He was a real nice guy. He was a good friend.
Oh, that's well,
so the NORAD man is really very important in my career because I did a lot of recording. We did nothing but go to Hollywood for 3 months every year from 1960 and 1961 and record all sorts of music, you know, mm-hmm. big, it was a 110-piece concert band, wow. as well as the Commander's big band, played dances and things like that. Mm-hmm. And that band, Bobby Shue came in, Bobby Shue, the trumpet player, back then he was a Chet Baker copier. Foo.
Really?
Foo.
Wow.
And you know, years later, I was doing a concert with these summer camps, and he was hired as a soloist with Louis Belson, and we're playing there with this faculty man, and he comes in, I hadn't seen him in 20 years, and he comes in and goes, shoo! You know, he's playing like Maynard Ferguson
he's
stuff.
He's gotten his leaping together, yeah.
What is he taking?
Yeah, right. I'll take one order of that.
So that NORAD experience, and then we go to New York for another month or two, both years, and record in New York and play in Carnegie Hall and all this sort of stuff. That gave me my recording experience and was totally, you know, really valuable to me.
Yeah.
So that when the... I left in 1962, and Chase, again, has always been a close friend. He called me up in May of 1962 from home. He says, are you interested? Nat Pierce has talked Woody. I should say Woody's band had diminished down to a sextet. And the times are tough. There was no big band.
Right, right.
This would be 59, 60. That band in 59, 58 was ragged.
Okay.
Really. And he wasn't getting any bookings and things like that. So he was working the Rooster Tail out in Detroit, which is a club. And it was Bill Chase, Gordon Briska playing tenor, Woody, and then the three rhythm section was Nat, Jake Hanna, and Charlie the Arm. And Nat talked, of course. Nat had a band here in Boston. He was a legend here. He's mm-hmm. also from Belmont, incidentally.
Oh, is that right? Wow.
That's true.
Okay.
Yeah. He talked Woody and said, now listen, I'll manage the band, take care of everything. All you have to do is walk out and stand in front of the band. And Woody agreed to it.
Why not?
Well, I think Abe Turchin also became part of this. And Woody always credited Abe as... keeping his career alive. If you have wondered why he let him get away with the shenanigans that he, you know, is beyond belief, right? But he did. I mean, he was the booker for that band.
So when you joined the band, was it still a small group, or had they gone back to the big band?
It was a brand new band.
Okay.
Absolutely brand new. Say, we're going to have rehearsals in New York. And this day, are you interested? I said, yeah, I'm interested. And he called all our friends, and I've got the list.
Let's get it out.
Let's see if I can find that quickly. Herb Pomeroy's band, yes. And Woody Herman's 62 to 65 band. Berklee musicians involved with Woody Herman's 62 65 band in the mid 50s were all in Herb Pomeroy's B band.
Okay. Best B band ever.
That was a good B band, that's right. Hoping to make Herb's A band, which was playing down nightly at the Staples. And these are the guys. Bill Chase was the lead trumpet, but there was another great, killer lead player of the same class as Bill. They used to work together with Maynard Ferguson. Mm. His name was Augie Ferretti. Mm. Killer player, and he died early, and he was a teacher, and he wasn't into anything funny. Mm. I don't know why. Paul Fontaine, great, wonderful player, melodic. Dusko Gojkovic, wonderful, beautiful player, also from Yugoslavia. Danny Nolan, local. Jerry Lammy, like you mentioned, he was the assistant lead. He's from Manchester, New Hampshire. Myself, Eddie Morgan, great trombone player.
Sure.
Cincinnati. Kenny Wenzel, another great trombone player, local. Bob Rudolph, a southerner, I think. That was the trombone sections. Here's your reed section. Gordon Briska, Jackie Stevens, you probably never heard of him. He was a beautiful player. Sad life. Mm. Tom Anastas, a baritone player. Frank Hittner, who is a marvelous clarinet player also. Also a baritone player. Jimmy Mosia.
Of course.
Alto. Jimmy Durber, tenor player. And then Jake Hanna.
Jake was originally Boston.
Yeah, wow. He was in the B band.
Wow. So it sounds like you better be in Herb Pomeroy's B band if you want to get a Woody's band anytime in the 60s.
Well, Herb was a major supplier of guys going into all sorts of bands.
Well, I'm sure you obviously
they call him.
You touched on it. He gave you all the right info to get you on the right track. Clearly, as you look back on those years with Woody, I know you said you did a total of 9 albums with the band. That's obviously a very aggressive recording schedule for, I know the bands recorded more back then, but still, in three years, whatever it was, to do 9 records is pretty pretty impressive amount of recording. Do you have a favorite that you look back on that?
Not really.
Okay.
If I had to say a favorite, it's the mosaic box set of everything we did on the Phillips label.
Okay.
That band was amazing because night after night after night after night for 2.5 years, I was there almost 3 years actually. It didn't change. The quality every night. I mean, we were playing some place up in Bachelor's Grove up in Montana or somewhere, and that band is just smoking.
Yeah.
One night, we're down. Who was the Wallace? Governor Wallace.
Oh, George Wallace of Alabama.
Right.
Yeah.
We're playing some sort of a thing down in Alabama, was it?
Yeah.
For him and.
Oh boy.
And so there, this is the same band, mind you. We play Ralph Burns charts mostly and Al Cohn, and beautiful charts. Magnificent. We used to look forward to, I look forward to the dance gigs because we'd play all of those beautiful charts that he wrote. So there's an MGM 10-inch recording of those Ralph Burns charts, East of the Sun, and you hear, it was that 52 band that did it with Carl and Irby, and gorgeous charts. Mm-hmm. Anyways, we're playing George Wallace's administration party, whatever it was, and there we'd play everything in two, Dancing in the Dark, and then roughly 2.5 hours later, we'd get to 4, after right. after people, you know what
after
I mean?
After we get the
enough.
Yeah.
Enough. So, and then 2 days later, we're in Harlem, and we're playing a big thing for in Harlem, and there we start right out in four.
Good choice. That's great. Well, Phil, if I may ask you this, especially for musicians of my generation and Kent, our great videographer and great trumpet player himself, you know, we were both huge Bill Chase fans, and a lot of the younger players now aren't even really that aware of who Bill Chase was. Of course, he died tragically in the airplane accident, but yeah, I know you were very close friends with him.
That's right.
Tell us your memories about Bill, and he went on to have a top 40 hit with his band Chase.
Get it on.
Yeah, I mean, it was like when I was in high school, that was the thing you wanted to listen to and play. But anyway, enough of me talking about it. Like, tell us your memories of Bill and just things that you look back on with him.
Oh, man. We were the lead trombone player to the played all the bands around in Boston in 1955, 6, 7, 8, just from the bands at Berklee, the B band. And we had just very similar desires musically, and he was influenced, as were so many of the trumpet players in Berklee in those days, by Lenny Johnson, who was one of the original Berklee faculty members, which we want to get into, incidentally.
That's my next.
Lenny was one of those teachers of us 12 from the beginning. As far as I'm concerned, my beginning, I should say, from 65, that bunch of teachers was incredible. The first year at Berklee, we had 419 students, 1965. The graduation class was 8.
Okay. Weeded them down, did you?
they all fit behind the sofa for the class picture, you know. So, coming from the very humble beginnings, we had 12 teachers, and we taught everything. I mean, I taught ear training, all sorts of stuff. Mm-hmm. Whatever needed to be done, we did it. And that was John LaPorter. Listen, I hear we're talking about this already.
No, this is great. It's a perfect segue. It's great.
Well, with John LaPorter, Lenny Johnson. Lenny Johnson, most people perhaps are not familiar with him. He was the trumpet player who would replace the lead trumpet player in Basie's band, or replace Cat Anderson in Duke's band whenever they felt that Cat needs to rest.
We'll read between the lines on that one.
and you'll be right. But Lenny would go out, and he could do all that stuff. And his time sense of playing lead trumpet in any band, it was just magnificent. Mm. And both Bill and I he was also the lead player in the A band.
Okay.
So we used to work at the local Italian club, the Surf, in Revere. And often they'd hire Lenny as the lead trumpet player, and I'd be the lead trombone player. I used to look forward to those moments because, you know, we could lock in on each other. And speaking of that, that's where Bill and I learned to lock in on each other.
Okay.
We were, and also I should point out, these ear plugs I'm wearing Probably is partially Bill's fault.
Yeah.
Because his trumpet was this far away from my head every night for 3.5 years. And every once in a while, actually this is a true story, this ear would rupture.
Oh boy.
And I would almost lose my hearing. It was frightening. It happened 2 or 3 times, and I'd have to go in and get to a doctor and have them clean the ear, and basically there would be a rupture there, and there would be a scab over it.
Oh, wow. Okay.
And they'd take it off and I could suddenly hear again.
Wow, okay.
And that happened to me 3 times during that time.
So that's
5 trumpets back there.
That's a lot of power.
Those guys can...
Bill's one of them, right? I mean, Phil, you bring up a really good point, which I think our viewers, especially younger viewers, should understand, and that relationship between the lead trumpet and the lead trombone is so important. I mean, the power that comes from that, and the arrangers of your ability or Bill's ability know how important that is, you know, and how to use that effectively.
That band, in the intonation buzz, you know what that is?
Sure.
That in that band was just uncanny. And if somebody happens to get out, chances are somebody's going to tell them. Yeah, you're having a little trouble tonight.
Yeah.
That child. Oh, maybe they wouldn't notice. You say
fantastic.
That band is the loudest band you ever played in your life, right? And indeed it was. But the fact is that once you get that intonation buzz happening, you're working... just half the intonation buzz gives you that extra
projection and everything just kind of locks. I know exactly what you're talking about,
and it's so easy to do that.
Yeah, I know. You think that you're having to work so hard at that volume, but actually you're absolutely so well said. It's easier. It's
right,
just if it's all locked up like that. Yeah,
and
absolutely.
The problem with working with a band that good is that when you leave, the rest of your life, you're looking for another band that good, and it's not going to happen.
Absolutely. It's like flying in first class for 5 flights, and then your first flight back in coach is not that great anymore.
Yeah, for sure these days. Oh, yeah.
Well, let's talk about... talk about Berklee if we can, and in your role as a faculty member and a professor. I think it is important, you touched on it as a student, but the state of jazz education at that time, mid-60s, was certainly not what it was going to become thanks to the work that you guys
did. Yes, that's right. Jazz was a dirty word.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and most, when did I put that book?
Well, let's take a look.
This is a real piece of history, because there are only, I don't know how many of these are left. We're talking about music education, jazz education.
Yeah.
Back in those days, at most universities, all over the country, all over the world, jazz was feared more than anything else. The writing was on the wall, you know, and you had all of these, the classical players, good players for Christ's sake, but they're scared they're going to lose their jobs, so there's a lot of back, you know. And so there were only a few places where a young person could go study jazz. If you wanted to go back a little further, 1945, the end of World War II, you had all these guys with the GI Bill rights pay for their college. You know,
right.
These guys have just been fighting a
sure.
war, Jesus.
So it's the least we can do for them.
Right. So... most of the guys like Quincy Jones, Benny Golson come to mind, and others wanted to study the music they loved, mm-hmm. which was jazz. Mm-hmm. And you could go only to two places, and you could only go to one at this point. It was, Berklee was first. It was known as the Schillinger House.
Oh, right, right.
In those days.
Yeah.
He was a composer who liked to use the slide rule and had all sorts of, interesting ways of looking at composition. He had more of an influence on what we were doing than I really knew, because I didn't quite understand it and all that sort of thing. But Larry Burke knew him well.
The founder of Berklee.
Berklee, yeah. Okay. And Larry quit a job in 1941 to come to Boston to teach, open a studio to teach piano. And going was rough, and Schillinger had started this little school down on Newbury Street, and so Larry went over and talked him into hiring him as a business manager, and the relationship worked. Mm. And then I think Schillinger died suddenly in 1965, maybe 4 or 5, right in there. And so it stayed Schillinger House, but Larry took over the.
Okay.
And it changed its name somewhere around, I think, 74, maybe. No, 1947, 74, right. Dyslexia.
Close enough.
Yeah. So that was one of the places, and that's where Quincy came and Benny Golson and all that. And the other place was North Texas State, which came along next. And I suspect there was something going on in Indiana, but I don't know that for sure. Mm. So anyways, we go fast forward to, let's go 65, way ahead.
Okay.
And we've got 419 students, and we've got 12, roughly, teachers who are taking care of everything. And it's beginning to grow. We're getting people who are really on the bottom rung, a lot of them. But then we get the absolute geniuses who come in, mm-hmm. like Ernie Watts.
Right.
And, we can look at the list.
Oh, yeah. We're going to be here for an hour if we go over the alumni of Berklee.
That's right. But this gives you an idea of these teachers. That's me. That's Lenny.
Uh-huh.
That's Herb. I don't know who the hell that is. This is Ted Pease. And John LaPorta, God bless him.
Okay.
Great teacher. He was the real thing. Teddy Casher, Charlie Mariano,
okay.
Ray Santisi. That's Herb conducting a band. There's Danny Nolan back there. Jack Stock. So, anyways, this book, that's Bill Levitt, John Bavicki, classical composer, who was actually he and I belonged to a fraternity at New England together.
Hmm.
This is Freddie Booter, who was a wonderful jazz drummer, but he became the percussionist for the Boston Symphony for years.
Oh, okay.
And a booker for all the big shows, theaters. Bill Levitt, who wrote the first book for guitars, jazz guitars,
mm-hmm.
one of the best books. Maybe not the first, but anyways, this gives you an idea of what.
Yeah.
Alan Dawson, the great drummer.
Oh, of course, yeah. At what point did Gary Burton enter the picture?
Gary actually was a student, I think in 19... 61, 2, 3, somewhere in there.
Okay.
And then went out and came back as a teacher, 68.
Okay.
Somewhere in
so
there.
Shortly after you joined on the faculty.
Yeah, he wasn't there for this. Anyways, you look at this and you can perhaps get a feel for the humility that these guys had.
Absolutely.
Had,
yeah,
all
we'll
of
get
them.
Some shots of that after we're.
And you get that sense from that. And I think the success today of Berklee, which is now worldwide, Valencia.
Right, I mean, the campus in Spain now, it's like,
exactly.
And when you see, I mean, this is kind of a broad question, but like when you go downtown and see the facilities that Berklee has now, it's become like a real estate empire. I mean, they have so many buildings and like gorgeous buildings and facilities. And what goes through your head, like seeing it from the humble beginnings to now?
Well, maybe I can give you a little story.
Sure.
You remember the Lowell State Theater, which is now the Berklee Performance Center?
Sure, of course.
Well, John LaPorter would say to Larry Burke, who I loved, we were very close. He would say, God damn it, will you pay the faculty and get where don't buy buildings? You know? And Larry, I'm going to buy it. And I remember going to that theater, this Class C movies, I mean, with Bill Berry. Do you remember Bill Berry?
Bill Berry, the trumpet player?
Yeah, of course. He was another student at Berklee from the early 50s. Yes. So Bill would make these Alice B. Toklas cookies, right?
Okay.
You know, instead of the chocolate chips.
Yeah.
So he would bring a big bag of this, and the two of us would go to that theater and up to the balcony with this bag of Alice B. Toklas cookies and watch Bomba the Wonder Boy.
Well, so sounds like a good thing he brought the cookies. I don't know if it made it a little easier to get through that.
So years later, this is now 1971 probably, Larry hires that theater to have the first Berklee High School Jazz Festival. And I'm walking through that scuzzy place, in the dust, you know, it had been abused for a long time. And he's saying, now, this is where we're going to put the room was, a special room, in the balcony, and we're going to move that wall over here. And, you know, he took me through all his plans to do that, and he finally did it. He pulled that off. It became, and is to this day probably the best room in town for that size, roughly 1,200 to 1,500 people.
Right. Yeah.
I love playing in there, but.
So do you feel like Lee's vision then in terms of expansion and growth and everything is, it seems like it's carrying on to this day? Do you sense a difference in approach, or do you feel like it's true to what the original vision was?
Well, I think the success of Berklee can be traced to the humility of the original faculty.
Mm-hmm.
That has permeated through the years to be the Berklee approach. And hence students tend to come there they're scared shitless now because it's got such a big reputation. Mm-hmm. But that they find that there's some shared feeling towards the student as they grow.
Mm-hmm.
Often at New England, the teacher was doing you a favor.
Mm.
I'm dyslexic. I can't read, right?
Mm-hmm.
My first piano lesson at New England was Bartok. You know, two things. I'm dyslexic. I'm looking at, which one am I going to play?
Even if you weren't dyslexic, I wouldn't start with Bartok.
Yeah.
Right.
That's the whole point.
Right.
That was it. And
yeah.
That guy also was a dean of the school at the time. Just wrong, you know. But anyways, what was the question?
Well, I think you've answered it very well, but just how you, do you feel like it's maintained its original vision to?
It's getting harder, I think,
uh-huh.
to be honest with you. They've annexed now the Boston Conservatory, so it's now the Boston Conservatory at Berklee.
Okay.
And that, we won't even go into the history of that, but it's a little harder to nurture that kind of environment that we had earlier. It's there, but there are actually other developing problems, such as I don't think we should go there.
Okay, fair enough. How about we, as far as Berklee, I would love to just throw out a couple names of some of your outstanding students that have been there. And like I said, it's like
I've got a list here.
Oh, let's get the list.
Come on. Well, we can start here.
Okay.
For trombone players, this come up. Let's see. We got Sam Burtis.
Oh, wow.
Was the first one.
Yeah. Okay.
Sam was an amazing tubist.
Okay.
And he could sing and play at the same time. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely.
In octaves, and it was infectious. I mean, it was really.
I bet.
But there's not too much call for that.
No.
So, he stuck to the trombone,
yeah,
and he was one of the top trombone players, and still is in New York.
Sure. Yeah.
Then there's Hal Crook.
Of course. Yeah.
And Tony Latta. Mm. And Keith O'Quinn, and Arthur Baron, Art Baron.
Yeah, sure.
Dennis Wilson, Delphio Marcellus, Frank Lacy, Elliot Mason.
Oh, wow, I didn't know Elliot. Man, this is great.
Oh, Elliot, I brought him over here, actually.
Oh, really? Wow.
Yeah, he was 16, and his parents, the mother is a singer.
Mm-hmm.
What are you, cabaret singer?
Mm-hmm.
And the father is a reed player, but I suspect he was a brass player because both Brad Mason
and Elliot.
Oh.
Yeah. Terrific. We had him on the show as a guest a couple years back, and it was great. Great talking to both of them.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we got Elliot out of his last year in high school in England to start at Berklee at a young age. And, then there's Jordan Murray. Ever hear of that?
No.
That's Australian.
Way. Okay.
Son of a bitch, he can play. Oh, and he writes, too. And there's Paul Knoll.
Okay.
That's
Paul the trombonist. Sure.
Rick Stepton. And there's a new guy who's attracting attention, Nick Vaganus. I can't pronounce it quite. V-A-Y-A-N-U-S.
Okay.
Who has started with me when he was 14 down in the cellar.
Nice.
Became the lead player in the dues band. Then those are trombone players. Some of the other people, John Schofield, Annette Cohen. Annette Cohen, the clarinetist, she was a tenor player from England. The one of three Cohens. There was Avishai Cohen, right. A great trumpet player, serious trumpet player. And there's Yuval Cohen, who is an alto player, who had a problem, had to learn how to play left-handed. Jesus, I've forgotten what the disease was. Mm. And then there's Annette, and it was me who talked her into playing clarinet.
Wow, good suggestion there.
Absolutely.
Made quite the star for herself,
Beautiful.
Beautiful player, yeah.
Stanton Davis. Mm. It was my outrageous records. I financed Stanton's album.
Oh, is that right?
Okay. Yeah, he was at New England when I took over the Afro-American department 3 years, having a fight with Larry Burke. So I went over. I needed to get some more money. So then there's Ernie Watts and Billy Pierce, the tenor player. Mm-hmm. Tommy Campbell, great drummer. He lives in Japan now. Roy Hargrove.
Mm. Yeah, rest in peace.
Right. Christian Scott, trumpet player. Piano players are Makoto Ozone, Danilo Perez, Cyrus Chestnut, Curl Gerstein. Do you know who he is?
I do not.
He's the son of a woman who was the vice president of the Voronezh Conservatory in Russia, 400 miles south of Moscow.
Okay.
He played piano from the age of zero on up. I mean, it just is like Makoto, which is funny. He wanted to play jazz, and he broke through security to talk to Gary Burton in St. Petersburg, you know, and he was 12, so he's about that tall. He just went under this, and he got him. And talked to Gary, and Gary was so impressed with this little kid, he got him a scholarship for that five-week program in the summer. Where I ended up being the mentor, as often happens with the young people. And he's brilliant. So much so that he became a full student. He could ever come into at age 13. He graduated when he was 16.
Nicely done.
No shit. But I mean, this guy's knowledge, a musical knowledge of the history of the music, it was just beautiful. I mean, we're talking of Shostakovich and Bach and Mozart. Mm-hmm. I ended up, and so did Gary, once a week playing with him. And I used to go out and try to do some of the things like we do with Makoto.
Uh-huh.
And no, he, you know, Makoto's Makoto.
Yeah, that's a special relationship.
And but the problem was, he would play rhythm changes, and he could never remember if he was on the second eight or the fourth. But meanwhile, he won all these Harvard Music Association awards for his classical playing. And for instance, I went to, Harvard thought Berklee was the pits. You know, you gotta be kidding. But he put on this show where he played 12 movements of Mozart's something, 35 minutes from memory. Hmm. Then he played a Brahms and then a Shostakovich and something else, all with no music, but from memory. And I turned around, I'm in the front row, and I turned around and all these old dudes, Harvard types, gray hair, tears coming down their eyes. They've never heard Mozart quite played that well.
Beautiful.
Beautiful, just, you know.
Well, that's a great story. Well, I'll tell you, Phil, I think we can safely say the list goes on and on. I think you've done your job. And I certainly think I didn't go to Berklee, but I know that I have many friends, Keith O'Quinn being at the top of the list, who say so many unbelievably fond things about what you gave to them and how important you were to their development. And clearly there's a reason why you were a distinguished professor at Berklee for over 50 years. So, and your passion for the institution and the growth and all that is it's so obvious when you talk about it. So even though I'm a non-graduate, thanks for all you did for the program.
Yeah.
Before we run out of time, we still got a little bit of time. I have to talk about your arranging career and your publications and whatnot. But if you don't mind, maybe we could start with the Mercy, Mercy, Mercy chart that you did for Buddy Rich's band. And I was an alumni of that band, but I know the way he was with arrangers, which could be kind of as gruff as he is with players if he wanted to be. But he obviously took a liking to that chart. And like I said, we were playing it in the mid-80s when I was on the band. But maybe talk about how you got associated with Buddy.
That's Buddy Rich's band. That's me rehearsing him.
We'll get a close-up of this so folks can see it a little bit better. And what year would you say this might be?
Well, this was right around, let's see.
Late 60s, early 70s maybe? Or?
There's Richie Cole. There's Pat LaBarbera.
That is Pat. Okay, that's what I was thinking.
There's Stepton. So this is probably 71.
Okay.
And Lenny's on the turnpike.
Oh,
rehearsing
yeah.
the band at 2 in the morning. they'd finish the show at 11, at 1 rather. They'd take a break and then would rehearse from 2 to 4. And
I seem to recall doing on my first year on the band doing a gig there. It's pretty legendary. Place no longer there, right? Is it still?
It's gone.
Okay, yeah. How did Buddy take to you rehearsing the band? I don't recall that going well for a lot of people.
I liked Gary. We were friends.
Okay.
He thought I was the corniest guy you ever saw. He said, Wilson, you are corny.
So how did you get associated with him as far as the chart goes?
You know the story. In 1967, teaching a class at Berklee of 9 to 11. I finish arranging class and I went into my office and the phone's ringing. I pick up the phone and it's Rudy Van Gelder. And he says, hello, did you write basically blues? And I said, yes, I did. He said, well, Buddy Rich just recorded it. Where do we send the check? I said, really? How did he get it? I didn't give it to him. Jim Trimble did.
Oh, okay. Legendary trombonist, yeah.
He replaced me in the NORAD band.
Oh,
so,
really?
So
wow.
We were roommates for my last 6 months in the band.
And then also followed you, or was on Buddy's band, I should say.
He took,
years later.
And became the manager for Buddy.
Oh, okay.
So that's how that happened, okay? So next time he came through town, I was there in the front row. I wanted to hear Basically Blues, played by Buddy Rich.
Yeah.
Because when I was 18 at New England Conservatory, I wrote that piece when I was 18, and I had exactly that Buddy Rich in mind.
Wow.
And I'll tell you why. When I was back in Phillips Exeter, when I was 10, 11, 12 in that area, there was, in that dormitory my father was responsible for with 64 boys in it, somebody left a set of drums in the basement from 20 years earlier.
Uh-huh.
I found it.
Oh.
Hello, Dolly. So Dad, my father, there was a address there, phoned the person who said, listen, my son found this set of drums. Where should we send it? You know, And he said, oh, don't bother. I'll give it to him. So I got this set of Gretsch drums.
Wow.
The bass drum looks like this bass drum.
Like Buddy's old...
That one.
Uh-huh.
That was the kind of drum. Wow. So it was back from the 30s, mind you, and the hi-hat would, with a little click, you know. And, oh. But anyways, I became a pretty good drummer. I would actually practice up in my room to a Buddy Rich playing on Opus 1, Well Get It. Remember that? Mm-hmm. I love that chart. Mm-hmm. All of those things he did with Dorsey. And I... Makoto was here 2 weeks, 3 weeks ago. And the first thing we said to each other, the only reason why we were so tight was we both learned our time from Buddy Rich. Mm. And that's the truth.
It's a great, great training ground, that's for sure.
Oh, it's the best. So here, you know, all of those, you know, you can just hear him doing that.
Yeah.
So, and Buddy used that to warm the band up for years. And then he gave me an assignment. He wanted some charts, and I am dyslexic. Writing is not, this takes a lot of time for me, just getting the, those, putting the damn notes between the, you know, it's slow, and I take a lot of time thinking about it.
Mm-hmm.
So he wanted Chelsea Bridge, Mr. Lucky, and Mercy Mercy. Cannonball had that big, he wants to ride on Cannonball's tails.
Sure, yeah.
And that's the one he was most interested in. And for some, I don't know how I pulled this off, but I actually wrote all three of them in 1 week. And that's amazing for me. And I, you know, so comes the Sunday afternoon session at Lenny's on the Turnpike. I've got the charts, and the place is packed, as it always was, Sunday afternoon. Oh my God, every fire law was violated. I mean, people hanging off the ceiling. But anyways, Buddy's over there, and as I walk in the door, the band's right here, and we had eye contact immediately, and he said, you got Mercy? I said, yeah, I do. He said, pass it out.
He's waiting for it.
Yeah, so we passed it out. We got a full house, and we did the audition. The rehearsal was in front of the full house. And I said, Buddy, those drum breaks are one bar more than you think it's going to be. You've got to be careful on that. And again, we had a good relationship. I really like Buddy Rich a lot. I hate, well, so we got a standing ovation for the rehearsal one time through.
That's awesome.
And I'm sitting going.
That could have gone a different way, and it didn't.
No shit. Yeah.
Well, you know, as I said in the intro, you know, we were still playing that chart in the mid-80s and on a regular basis. So he, whatever he paid you, he got his money's worth out of it because he was playing that all the time. But he obviously had great respect for you and your writing, and that chart is a lot of fun to play.
Did
you ever get to play it? Like,
are you kidding? I played that all over the world.
Okay, awesome. Yeah, I'm sure you did take advantage of that. Let's talk about, if we can for a second, the Outrageous Mother Publications publishing.
Rich Matteson.
And Jack Peterson and yourself.
I've got a picture of those guys here.
We'll grab that afterwards, and that kid can't shoot that. But you guys are three legendary pioneers in jazz education, but also as a publisher, you guys decided, let's do it ourselves. What was the motivation behind that?
Get our music out.
Okay.
And we were also... you mentioned the paper and all
the
of that.
Quality
that
was aspect. Exceptional.
Yeah, and that Rich. I mean, basically, Rich was the leader in putting outrageous publications together. He had the set it all up financially. It was his idea. We want to have the paper be of a professional size, professionally produced, just like if you would be going out and playing with the Dorsey Band or something like that. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, that beautiful image that Rich had a friend in Iowa who pulled that one off. Do you know that?
He was the one who drew the logo image. That's the cover on every one of these charts. It was just, you got it. It was this fantastic image of he was the outrageous mother, I guess.
Well, the educators in the state of Rhode Island finally said, we're going to have to take that can of beer out to the side. So they...
Oh, come on, guys. Let's have fun.
That's true.
Really?
This is actually true. They said, no, we will not allow anybody to buy your product unless you change that. They were outraged.
Okay.
That hard right.
Yeah, yeah. You know, unfortunately, we know a little about that. Yeah. But anyway.
We won't go there. But that went for 14 years, you know.
Okay.
And among the things that were really big sellers were some of the best charts that Rob McConnell
wrote. Rob wrote the charts for that. Right.
Yeah, The Waltz I Blew for You.
That's a
beautiful chart.
Oh, wow, yeah.
Yeah.
I completely forgot that Rob McConnell was associated with you guys. That's amazing, yeah.
Yeah, those were his best charts published.
Uh-huh.
Because when Hal Leonard finally bought them, all of a sudden they're telling him you can't go above here.
And he was writing for his band in Toronto, so he's great players. And
beautiful band.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah. Yeah, that's awesome. Well, thanks for sharing us and reminding us about that. It was like, I always just remember seeing those charts when I was in high school, and the quality was just like, wow, that is like really good. Of course, the writing was fantastic, but right down to the paper and just everything about it was first class.
Yeah.
It was a good lesson for somebody like myself. And Phil, as we kind of wind down a little bit, and we're going to have a very special treat. Hopefully, we'll get you to get over to the piano here at the very end as we close out. I just wanted to ask you a couple more things. You played with Louis Armstrong on the 1964 Grammy Awards, and you already talked about what an influence he was on you. What was that experience like? I can only imagine.
It was probably my greatest music lesson.
Really? Okay.
It was at the Astor Hotel. Again, I have a picture of this.
Okay, great.
Popsy, the renowned photographer, took a couple of pictures, which I've found out about and immediately bought. There is a certain guilt. You take a picture, or you have a picture taken with Louis Armstrong, that meant so much to me. I mean, but then it becomes, I'm using his image to further my own career, you know. And there's sometimes some mixed feelings that go on there on both sides of the question. Mm-hmm. And aside from that, put that aside, because...
Well, you were playing with him too. It's not like just getting a photo. You were sharing the stage with him.
Oh, man, it was so easy. For me, I mean, beforehand, backstage, I'm back there. It's a huge ceiling, and I've cut my mouthpiece on. Woody walks by. What are you doing? And then he looks at me and goes, Louie. Yeah, and he walks away. I there were two trombone players that really had a huge influence on me early in life, and Jack Teagarden's one, and of course that's with Louis, the right. All-Stars. Mm-hmm. And I could play, or I knew most of his lines, mm-hmm. around Millenburg Joys and this and that, you know. And I'm playing it with Louis, good Lord. And so I'm playing Jack Teagarden. That's really what I'm doing. And it was so easy, and it was so much fun. Mm. It was just, Woody was playing clarinet, and Woody's a good clarinet player,
baby. Sure.
So, and Billy Kyle, which is Louis' piano player, came in with him, and then Jake played drums, and Charlie the Armor played bass.
Oh, wow.
And we had about an hour rehearsal. In the rehearsal, in the afternoon, Louis walks out on stage, and you got this huge ballroom, and people are setting chairs and glasses and, you know, everything. But when Louis walks in, takes the horn out, everybody stops. It's just amazing. It's beautiful, mm-hmm. you know. And we played for about probably 45 minutes to an hour, just run through four or five tunes. Of course, Hello Dolly is why he's there.
Okay.
So and then that night, the same thing happens again. When he's introduced, he comes out and we start to play Muskrat Ramble, and everything stops. The schedule just goes out. And the funny part about doing that, because, I mean, the Grammy Awards in those in 1964 were not as big as they are now. I mean, it's
sure.
it's just blown like the Berklees.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
Just grows. We all, for every category, we don't know who the winners are, right? Mm-hmm. So for each category, we've got this little packet of music, and when they announce it, we've got to come up with one of five sheets.
Mm.
Yeah. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
So they'd announce, and here she is, Dolly Parton, and you'd hear the drum, you'd hear the piano, you'd hear maybe one trumpet player, probably the third, and and then you'd hear sounds like this. You know what I mean?
I know exactly what you mean.
And, and by the time whoever it is gets to the microphone, you'd have the full band.
Yeah, I mean, in time to play four or five beats and
right.
music complete, right?
Yes.
That's awesome. Wow, that's what a great story.
Oh, yeah. But
boy, what we wouldn't give to hear Louis Armstrong on the Grammy Awards now. Boy, it's come a long way, and I'm not sure for the better.
But, yeah, which direction are we going?
It is different, that's for sure. Well, another one, as we wind down, Phil, I mean, what greater honor than the great city of Boston proclaims December 9th, 1995, yeah. Phil Wilson Day. What, as a native Boston, a diehard Red Sox fan, you personify Boston. What did that mean to you?
Oh, man. I mean, what can you say? I mean, it's... you say, really? I'm so lucky to have loved what I've done, been doing all these years. You know, when you connect all the three elements of my life, which is why I'm still smiling. This is the trombone player. There's the arranger, composer, mm-hmm. and then there's the educator. What holds those three together? Why? And it's very simple, and this goes back to Louis again, it's communication.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
As a teacher, as a musician, and as a writer. And if you've got that ability to get your music across the moat to the real people. Mm. Oh, shit, you know about that yourself, mm-hmm. you know. Mm-hmm. What more do you want out of life? I mean,
beautiful. That is awesome. And if I may say so, I mean, we had Justin DeChocho, a great jazz educator, on a couple of years back, and he basically could have been describing your career. He said, you've got to perform, you've got to write, and pedagogue and teach.
Yeah.
And you've done all three of those things at the highest level and consistently. And it's funny, Kent and I were talking on the drive up today from New York. It's communicating, and always like in every way, you know, as a human uh-huh. being and certainly as a musician, but you did that and you did it and you do it and you're doing it consistently, and it's the only way to go. Great man. Lesson for all of us.
Thank you.
Phil, I don't know what to say except thank you for everything. You've done so much for the trombone, for music, for jazz, for education, for arrangers, all of it. We thank you, and it's an honor to be in your presence and be here in your home today. Thank you so much. And,
God, you're welcome. And, thank you for coming.
And we're going to get some shots. Kent's going to get some shots of these incredible photos that you have, but maybe we could, can we coerce you into playing a tune for us as we roll our final credits?
You certainly can.
All right. Thank you, Phil. Thank you.